From our studio in our office at the corner of 8th and Walton in Bentonville, Arkansas, welcome to Saturday Morning Meeting, brought to you in part by Dun & Bradstreet Credibility Corp., the leading provider of credit and credibility solutions for businesses. Saturday Morning Meeting covers Walmart, Sam's Club, and the consumer product companies that are represented on the racks and shelves throughout the country and around the world. Our focus is on the insights, trends, and best practices to help you as a supplier grow your business with the world's largest retailer. I'm Andy Shook, and thanks for joining us. Today, we have a special extended Swimming in the Sea of Data. Jeff Amerine talks with the Sustainability of Consortium's Dr. Jon Johnson and Dr. Sarah Lewis about sustainability and retail. And then, Jeff Clapper will meet with board members of the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation and discover how suppliers can get involved in the heart of business in Northwest Arkansas. But first, the headlines. Walmart's new priority is expanding the development of its smaller footprint stores. Now, these plans apparently also include condensing its small store branding. BidNessetC.com reports that Walmart will cease the development of Walmart Express stores in the favor of creating new neighborhood markets. In addition, all 21 Express stores will be rebranded as neighborhood markets. The decision was made after a survey revealed that customers shopped at both stores for similar reasons, negating the need for two separate brands. The kids have spoken. Each year, Walmart asks kids to help select the holiday season's hot toys. Walmart released its findings from this year's test, some of which proved surprising. While items bearing the likeness of popular TV and movie characters, such as Elsa from Frozen, proved to be winners, many kids showed a strong preference for artsy and classic toys, such as children's sewing machine and the Fisher-Price Little People musical preschool. There's been another change in the executive lineup at Walmart. Time reports that David Tovar, who began working for Walmart in 2006 and is now Vice President of Communications, has stepped down after allegations that he misrepresented his educational credentials. The discrepancy focuses on Tovar's resume, which claims that he holds a bachelor's degree from the University of Delaware. According to the school, Tovar left before completing the program. Tovar offered high praise for Walmart in his resignation email. This is a sad story, but it sounds like David is leaving with character and integrity.
Hello, I'm Iris Rorwick. Last week, I attended the Sam's Club Co-Managed Summit. I'm here today to share some of the key takeaways. The theme of the Supplier Co-Managed Summit was the review of the launching of GRS, Global Replenishment Solutions, Driving Savings, Made Simple by Providing the Right Product and the Right Price at the right time and, by the way, at the right quantity. Exciting announcements were made. We had breakout sessions, and also we had key initiatives that were presented. GDSN item submission was one of the key initiatives. Through the GRS portal, co-managed suppliers can participate in accurate forecasting and ordering and their items. More than 1,400 suppliers are currently on the GRS system today, and 18 categories have been completed. This contributes to over half of their overall sales. Once the entire corporation goes live on GRS, there will be over 100 million item combinations. Sam's Club announcements included the offerings of cash rewards and the transition of the Sam's Club credit card from Discover to MasterCard, with an enhanced technology chip offering more security to their members. The introduction and focus of micro holiday offerings in addition to major holiday offerings, and the plan to include e-commerce in the future. The importance of reducing freight costs, decreasing lead times, and creating more accurate and timely ordering was highlighted, and increased focus on vendor pooling and truckload optimization. Look for another Insider Scoop next week.
This week, Jeff Amerine and Dr. Jon Johnson and Dr. Sarah Lewis of the Sustainability Consortium discuss the sustainability movement and how CPG companies can use a life cycle assessment to gain a competitive advantage.
Today I'm here with Dr. Jon Johnson and Dr. Sarah Lewis of the Sustainability Consortium. These are two of the global thought leaders in the sustainability movement. Folks, thanks for coming in. Really glad you're here. John, tell us a little bit about what you've been up to the last few years.
Well, I've been in the Walton College for about 18 years. I teach strategy and organization theory there, as well as ethics and social responsibility. In the last few years, I've been very involved in the sustainability movement, working in particular with Walmart and some of their leading suppliers on measurement and reporting.
Got it. Sarah, what about you?
I am Managing Director of Research and Integration at TSC, and have been with TSC for 3.5 years, working with companies and organizations to help them build the systems that we develop, as well as use the systems that we develop, and have a background in environmental sciences, a PhD in environmental dynamics, and have been a consultant with companies as well as an educator in the environmental sciences.
Great. Well, thank you both again for coming in. So let's launch into this a little bit. I mean, the retail and consumer packaged goods space is obviously significantly impacted by the kinds of stuff that you've been working on in sustainability. So how are the CPG brands using life cycle thinking to drive their product development decisions? How's that working?
I would say what we're seeing is that companies are finding that it helps them manage risk as well as set goals to look at the entire life cycle of the products that they manufacture or sell. And this helps them understand what are the impacts associated with energy, water, waste, transportation, worker health and safety, and helps them set goals and then be able to consistently measure and report progress on those goals related to those issues.
I got it. Got it. Very holistic view. And I'll take a step back, you know, just to get some of your insights here. It's been nearly 10 years since Lee Scott sort of set this sustainability mandate down. What's it looking like now? 10 years later, what's the situation?
When Lee laid out the sustainability vision for the company, he established three long-range goals, aspirational goals for the company. And those goals are still very much in effect today. They still guide a lot of the decisions that the company's making. One was around waste, another was around energy. And if you look inside the company's footprint, both of those goals have had substantial impact on how they do business. Walmart is the leading buyer of solar equipment in the U.S. They've substantially increased the energy efficiency of their stores and their DCs. They've saved a lot of money in the process, billions of dollars, I'm sure. Their fleet efficiency has gone up substantially, upwards of 80%, I think, which is astronomical if you think about it in just a few years. So those two goals, which are very in-footprint goals, have been very important for how they run the company. The third goal is around products and selling more sustainable products. It's a much harder goal for the company to achieve because they're dealing with thousands and thousands of suppliers. There has not been a good system for evaluating products on sustainability metrics before, and so it's been a longer range goal, a little bit slower in coming. But thankfully, due to some of the work we're doing and some other work that's out there, that's a much more attainable goal. So I think companies should expect to have more conversations with buyers at Walmart and other retailers around sustainability.
And Sarah, as the brands and the CPG players begin to look at energy and waste and water and transportation, what sort of data tools are out there that you're working on that would be helpful?
There are a number of types of tools, certainly looking at what we might say a hotspot analysis, so what are the big impacts in the life cycle of a product. Life cycle assessment is a method that is often used to really assess and do an inventory of what the impacts might be related to energy, what inputs are going into making a product, and how can I manage that and reduce it or create efficiencies. And so the tools that TSC develops are based in life cycle assessment and are being used to really improve that decision-making capability about what issues should I focus on, where can I make improvements, what practices can I implement to really create efficiency, but also be able to communicate progress and really market that progress to customers or consumers.
So the tools really allow the companies to try to attack that triple bottom line.
Right. And having the tools that help you collect those data to track and measure progress is really important.
Got it. That's great. You know, as you think about some of the common misperceptions about sustainability, what has your research shown? How can you debunk some of that thinking?
I can touch on that in saying that one thing that we see is some of the learning has been that while there are certainly unique characteristics within a product category, say milk, mm-hmm. That there are actually commonalities between the issues in milk, yogurt, ice cream and butter, and that we can merge those into a product category approach, and therefore enable and scale action in those areas. And so we've been able to really help learn that there are common issues such as energy and water that are across the board, and there's ability to address those collectively and not have to take every single SKU separately, that they can be addressed at a product category level.
It's a kind of a breadth approach. There's also a depth approach. We've used life cycle assessment language a lot in the interview up till now. Mm-hmm. Life cycle assessment is a methodology that, as the name implies, looks at impacts at every point in the life cycle of a product. And when you do that, it's very much environmental accounting. When you do that, you identify the areas in the life cycle of the product that really have the impact, and it allows you to see where you should focus your energy. Mm-hmm. So one of the debunking activities, oftentimes consumers, we're all consumers, we take packaging off of products and we throw it away. It's what we see. And oftentimes there's an assumption that the packaging is where the impact is. If you actually do a life cycle assessment of a consumer product, usually it's not the packaging that's the highest impact area. It's always going to be an impact because every product has it. But for agricultural products, it's oftentimes on farm. For electronics, it's oftentimes in the consumer use phase, and et cetera. And LCA allows you to get that kind of vision.
So there's some things that would somewhat be intuitive or emotional sort of thoughts about this that the data totally debunks and allows you to make much better decisions.
Oftentimes, don't debunk things so much as bring additional clarity to. So it gives you additional insights.
Got it. Well, I'll tell you what, we're going to take a quick break, and before we continue to talk about smaller brands and how they can benefit from these sorts of tools in the sustainability movement, we'll be right back.
Bentonville Commerce, less than 1 mile from the Walmart home office. You'll love the convenience, amenities, and customized options Bentonville Commerce offers. For more information or a tour, call 479-200-1112 today.
GigWalk is an on-demand mobile workforce that can collect data and do work at retail. Businesses use GigWalk for retail audits, merchandising, and much more. With 350,000 smartphone-enabled workers available on demand, you get unprecedented speed and coverage across the U.S., Canada, and the U.K., and all work is reviewed for quality and accuracy. Visit GigWalk.com to learn more.
We're back with the Sustainability Consortium's Dr. Jon Johnson and Dr. Sarah Lewis. Well, let's continue talking about some of these important issues as it relates to the smaller brands. What can some of the smaller brands or retailers do in terms of life cycle cost analysis and the whole sustainability movement?
Historically, doing an LCA has been very expensive. Each company has had to do the analysis pretty much from the ground up. In recent years, up to and including work that the consortium is doing, there's been a lot of work done to democratize that so that that kind of data and those kinds of insights are becoming much more available to small brands and small retailers. And the kinds of things that it brings to them are the same kinds of efficiencies and effective opportunities that the larger companies have been able to take advantage of, things like getting insights into where costs are in their supply chains, in addition to impacts in supply chains and life cycle.
But do adopting these sorts of things still represent a competitive advantage, or is it just now a cost of doing business, you pretty much have to do it?
For the creative companies, it's going to be a competitive advantage, right? So the companies that are leaning forward into this, I think, are going to be able to see opportunities for efficiencies and for other kinds of opportunities. That said, what you said I think is absolutely right. The ante to play the game is going up. This is kind of a Red Queen problem.
Eventually the arbitrage erodes a bit and you just have to do it to maintain your
position
in the market.
Sustainability is no different from any other kind of competition.
I got it. Sarah, you know, decisions driven by meaningful insights can really drive real value, but getting the adoption and sort of integrating that in the culture is sometimes difficult. How do you see that happening in the client companies you work with?
It's very exciting, actually, and you are hearing from TISI members that the sustainability teams and the tools that they use are they're using those tools to really help integrate across departments in companies. Sustainability is an interdisciplinary field, and it's important to create connections between departments and in just through the mere fact that communication can create efficiencies. That is something that we're hearing as a benefit. I would say also that, as I mentioned earlier, there are cross-sector learnings. So you can learn from your packaging and your paper teams and your food, beverage, and ag teams when those sustainability teams create those discussions. And so that's some cultural changes that we're seeing and hearing about from the companies that we work with.
And they have to come armed with the data.
That's right. The data and the tools that provide help them have those tools that help provide that data give them the story that they can tell and use to really onboard and advocate for addressing issues within the product categories they make.
What role is the consumer playing in all this? As you look at it, I mean, we often wonder, what impact is it having? Are they driving the conversation? Are they passively participating in it? What do you see from the consumer in all of this?
What we're hearing is that consumers want to feel good and feel trust in the places they shop and the brands they purchase. And they want to know that they can feel good about purchasing that, and that there isn't a risk that later they will find out that there was a building that's collapsed in that product supply chain, or a misinformation about the type of product that it is. Mm-hmm. And so that's been an important thing that I know retailers talk about, is they want their customers to feel good and be able to trust that where they're shopping, and use that as a decision point.
So they're not using that as a litmus for initial purchase necessarily, but it's almost like insurance for the brand equity, in a way that they want to feel good that it's an authentic push towards sustainability.
I think there's an aspect of transparency there, and understanding the life cycle of your products that you sell or make is a way to minimize that risk and build trust.
The research on point of purchase decisions and behaviors in the store is very complex right now. So almost all consumers, or at least a very large proportion of consumers, say they care about sustainability. When it comes to behavior, what you see is certain product categories, it does translate into choice. So if the product is something they consume or put on their body, or more importantly, consumed by their children, mm-hmm. it's something that you do see behaviors change around. For other products, it's a much more complex decision.
Yeah, very interesting. As you begin to forecast what the next 3 to 5 years are going to look like, we've got just a little bit of time left. Give us a few words on where this is all going with sustainability and the sorts of things that you've been working on.
Companies are using data to set goals and using tools to measure progress against those goals. They're using initiatives and convening through initiatives to set those goals. And in 3 to 5 years, what I foresee is that we'll see some clarity on where people are with those goals through having used those tools.
So a lot of the goals are going to be given to the companies by others outside of the company. Mm-hmm. Retailers, Walmart foremost among them, are going to be asking more questions about the products that are being sold to the company that they sell to their consumers. So I think that's something that's going to be more and more visible over the next 3 to 5 years. Mm-hmm. You're going to see NGOs, the campaigning civil society organizations, continue to put pressure on companies, retailers, as well as branded manufacturers, to improve the product sustainability of their products as well. So I think those are all going to be increasingly
important. It kind of looks like it's setting up a virtuous system with checks and balances on all sides.
Absolutely. The reporting environment that we're helping create and that companies are driving is going to require that.
I got it. Well, folks, this has been a fantastic discussion around LCA sustainability, the whole sustainability movement. Thanks for coming out today. I really appreciate it. Be sure to tune in next week for Swimming in a Sea of Data. Saturday morning meeting will continue shortly.
Every day, shoppers are bombarded with traditional brand messages outside the store in hopes that these marketing dollars will drive in-store sales. Closure Media drives retail sales by connecting brands with 95 million Walmart shoppers per year while they are in the store. Through innovative programs at Walmart's photo and money centers, Closure Media converts Walmart shoppers to purchasers of your brand. With reported redemption rates up to 7 times the national FSI average, Closure Media drives sales. For more info, visit us at closuremedia.com.
K-Stack, the leader in collaborative retail consolidation programs. We offer the supply chain expertise needed to navigate the challenges of selling products with the world's largest retailers. And we provide customers with a customizable, scalable, environmentally sustainable supply chain with the same advanced technology typically used by larger rivals. By leveling the playing field, K-Stack lowers distribution costs and increases overall margins. K-Stack, retail logistics is what we do. Bentonville Plaza, across the street from the Walmart home office. The best office location offers proximity and services like no other business complex in the area. Call 479-200-1112 today.
Up next, Jeff Clapper meets with the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation board members who share how a supplier can get involved and discuss an exciting upcoming event.
Today I'm here with the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation board members, Link Robinson, Brent LaRoche, and Mike McFadden, to discuss how a supplier can get involved in the local community. Before we really get into the conversation, I just want to point out that the normal uniform on the show is some kind of dark jacket and button-down shirt. You've all got something a little more special and punchy. I like it. Can you talk about that for just a second? Anyone?
Yeah, sure. So with our event, it's unique in itself that it's a fly fishing event. Mm-hmm. You usually have golf events or other functions. So we're wanting to make sure we make a statement here and let people know this is a great casual event and a lot of fun.
It was my idea, by the way.
You did show up with the shirts. That was great. And does it, I know we'll get to this, but does a supplier need to be into fishing or anyone to be a participant or involved in this?
Okay. Not at all. Okay. We have guides provided, and if you don't have any skill at all, you'll be just fine.
Great. Well, now that we've got that covered, let's take a step back and just talk about the cystic fibrosis, mm-hmm. the foundation itself. Can you talk about sort of what this illness is and the impact it has on the lives of the individuals who have it and their
sure.
families?
Yeah. So my son Luke is 16 years old. He was diagnosed with CF when he was 8 months old. So it's a genetic disease. You either have it or you don't. So it affects mostly the lungs and the pancreas. So the lungs tend to develop infections in this thick, sticky mucus. So there's lots of preventative treatments and things that you have to do a day. He does about an hour and a half of vest treatment a day that
pounding the
that
mucus,
knocks the mucus, yeah. and then he takes about 40 pills a day to help him digest food. And help him stave off infection. So
it's really has a huge impact on, mm-hmm. on that life. Yeah, mm-hmm.
It's normal to him. You know, he's been doing it forever. So
yeah. In some ways, you get used to mm-hmm. your reality, whatever that may be. But it's a tough day to day life, I'm sure.
That's right.
Yeah, and talk about the foundation then, and its purpose and mission.
So the foundation is really about improving the lives of every individual with cystic fibrosis. So they do that by having events like this and having great sponsors and. What they do is they fund research to find better treatments and ultimately a cure for cystic fibrosis. So mm-hmm. lots of progress has been made. When my son was diagnosed in 1999, the life expectancy was in the early 30s. Today it's in the early 40s. So wow. That's huge progress. There's a lot of progress being made towards a cure as well. Mm-hmm. It's something that treats the core defect of the disease versus just treating a symptom.
That's great. Yeah, and briefly, I know one of the things from my own knowledge is that this is not a disease that affects enough people that pharmaceutical companies want to invest in the research, and so that makes this support all the more important.
That's right. Yeah. There's 30,000 people in the United States that have cystic
yeah.
fibrosis.
So from a business perspective, we can all understand if that was the universe that your company was targeting, you would just say, this is important, but it doesn't make sense. But that's great.
And the foundation funnels that money into the people that can use it the best.
That's great. Thank you. So, Brent, can you talk a little bit about, kind of going back to the fishing and talk about where this event's history has been and this upcoming event specifically?
Sure. So, back in 1988, Gary Ellis and his family, Susan and his daughter, Nicole, at the finding that their daughter had cystic fibrosis and their knowledge of what the disease was and the resources that were limited, started the Red Bone series, it started with 13 boats down in Isla Morada, and he raised about $16,000. His main support was Rich Products and his good friend Bob Rich, and from that point it blossomed into a 25-event series that runs annually and across the Eastern Seaboard, into Costa Rica, the Bahamas, and now even to the middle of the country where we do a lot of freshwater fishing.
That's great. And fly fishing is generally not something you think of in the middle of the country, is that correct?
No, it's very common. Link can speak to that a little more.
Yeah. I mean, Arkansas is a mecca for fly fishing, but okay. It's usually on the eastern side of the state.
This goes to show how little I know about fly fishing. I'm not even going to suggest, how little knowledge I have. I'll just let my silly question speak for itself.
By the time we walk out, you will be a fan.
I hope so.
It is limited in this side of the state, though.
Okay. So. Got it. And so, talk about the event now. From our audience is Walmart and its suppliers. So, who's involved and why and where. And how can they get more involved if they aren't yet?
Sure, Rich Products is really the title sponsor, and they've been involved in all the red bones. But this is unique in the fact that we have food companies, sporting good companies, companies like Kimberly-Clark. So it really is open to everybody. We have ranges to get involved in from $15,000 to $1,500 a team. There are two-man teams. We have 20 teams. Mm-hmm. So it's a great day, 2 days of fishing and awards, and we have the final event at our best ballpark, and it's just a fantastic location.
And Rich Products is obviously pretty tied into
the Naturals. Yeah, with the Naturals and Rich family owning the Naturals, so yeah, it all meshes well together.
What a neat event, just in terms of pulling together all the resource and knowledge and talent and natural resource that's here in Northwest Arkansas for a great cause.
And it's a very unique event. It's not the typical gala type event.
Sure.
It's something different and a little more casual.
I love it. Yeah, that's really cool. That's great. Thank you so much for joining us and for all the work you're doing to support cystic fibrosis and our community. Saturday morning meeting will continue in a minute.
I'm here with Stan Zalowski of Movista. Stan, welcome.
Thank you.
Wearable tech. What is wearable tech all about?
Well, it's about everything technology is about, which means faster, smarter, smaller, right?
Okay.
Let's talk about a few examples that are out there.
Yeah.
And they're out there now. This isn't all crazy
so
science fiction.
This isn't science fiction.
I'm not talking science fiction
today.
Gotcha. So fingertip scanners that are connected to a smart device that's on your wrist. So take a telezone. Okay. Shrink it down to the size of a watch.
Put it on your finger.
Put the fingertip scanner there. You read the barcode. You get your activities here. You're punching in your responses. Everything's happening. Hands-free activity, right?
Wow.
Smarter. All the stuff is going to be connected. It's going back up to the cloud, and everyone's going to be able to have access to that data. Pretty cool.
That is cool. That is cool. Well, that could affect suppliers as well as retailers.
You bet. Absolutely. Well, it could affect consumers ultimately if they care enough. I don't see my mom with a fingertip scanner.
No, probably
Doing price checks. But, a lot of this technology, that we're going to see it start in the operational side of the business, right, with the vendor teams that are out in the field or retailers who have folks on the floor. But it's going to spread over. So the next thing I would talk about is Google Glass.
Okay.
So talk about Google
Glass.
Google Glass
or the glasses, right?
Yeah, the glasses.
Okay.
You see people infrequently now with Google Glasses.
Okay.
But I think if you look at, I have a team in the field of 200 or 300 or 500 people, it may be an investment I want to make. Why? Because, again, we're back to hands-free. We're doing our work. We're getting our work done faster, more efficiently. We're able to communicate with each other through those glasses. Really, really cool stuff.
What else?
The last thing, and probably the one that's going to resonate most with people, is just a simple wearable watch, right? A smart watch, if you will, where we're getting communication from home base. Home base maybe knows where you are, which is good for everybody.
Okay.
So I think you're going to see that probably speed ahead of the other two in terms of adoption, but probably the least powerful, soonest to come about.
Right. Well, these are all things that are happening right now, and we're looking forward to seeing them and seeing how they affect suppliers and retailers out there in the future. Well, Stan, thank you so much for coming in today. We really appreciate it. We look forward to what you bring us next time. Now, this has been Retail Insights presented by Movista.
My colleagues and I were lucky enough to have a custom course put together for us by Ethan Walton, IRS, our instructor. It focused on all the different aspects of what an analyst might need from retailing to work with Walmart. I think what surprised me most is that there were so many things that I had not been using in Retail Link that would be valuable for me and that I hadn't attempted to use yet. And also just some tips and shortcuts. Iris has a lot of experience and she knows how to help you find things that are going to help you do your work.
Our thanks to all of today's guests. Now join us next week for a very special episode on OSA. We'll speak with leaders across the supplier, service provider, and academic landscape. As always, we appreciate your taking the time to join us. If you have questions or comments, we'd love to hear from you. I'm Andy Shook, and from all of us at Saturday Morning Meeting, Thanks for watching. Our guests enjoy staying at 21C Museum Hotel and hosting dinners, meetings, and product launches there.